Thank you, Jay. Thank you, Dan. Great job in Los Angeles. And welcome once again to the World Center of Racing, Daytona International Speedway. It is time for qualifying in the NASCAR Xfinity Series. Today's coverage presented by Geico. 47 cars are here. 40 will make the field for this afternoon's 300-miler. And the weather in Daytona, well, it's what you would expect in Daytona this time of year. It's warmed up today. Right now we're at 62 degrees. It's breezy out there. That could impact the qualifying session. But we look good for the rest of the afternoon. With Michael Waltrip and Phil Parsons, I'm Adam Alexander. And guys, things look different today for qualifying when you look at the rules compared to last weekend.
Yeah, you're going to have four groups tear out there and run for 2.5 minutes. And each one of those groups, the fastest 24 times, advanced to round two. We'll split them in half. Even number cars go in one pack, odd in the next, and then we'll take the fastest 12 and race for the pole. The interesting thing, Phil, there's differing agendas. Some guys are just trying to get in a lap. They know it really doesn't matter where they start. Some guys say, I got to get the pole, and then others are going to be racing, qualifying for their life. They got to get in tonight, today on time so they can race later this afternoon. And that makes it interesting.
And these rules were just changed this week, and you would think you only have 2.5 minutes. There's going to be no strategy, but there is strategy. We saw that in Truck Series qualifying yesterday. You get a run on a pack, you're going to run a fast time.
Yeah, and you might want to delay your exit from pit road to get around a certain car or another. And when you take that chance, you might get left by the pack and not be able to get in that fast lap. A lot of nerves right now on pit road, Adam.
If you're thinking about favorites for the pole, perhaps the man that won the title 1 year ago, Chase Elliott, would be on the short list. He's with our Jamie Little. Hello, Jamie.
Hello, Adam. It was quite a year for then-rookie Chase Elliott. 3 wins, and he takes the championship. You only finish outside the top 10 7 times, but 2 of those came right at this racetrack. What is so challenging about Daytona?
It's just so much plays into the day, and you just never really know exactly how it's all going to work out. So you try to be smart, and you try to put yourself in a good spot, you know, and a lot of times it's not the right one. So I learned a lot throughout last year, and I think the two plate races here and learned a couple things yesterday throughout practice. So I hope I can do a better job here than I did last year. It was a struggle for us. So I hope today goes better. Looking forward to it. Hopefully we can have a good race here for Napa.
This is a new qualifying format. We have 4 rounds here, 4 groups in the first round. What do you expect?
I don't really want to overcomplicate it. I think it's a big thing. Everybody's asking all these questions about what to do. I think just go run, make a lap, line up single file, and just try to make the most of your group and try not to overcomplicate any more than that. So that's what we're going to try to do, and hopefully it works out.
All right, Chase Elliott making his debut with his new crew chief here.
Brad Keselowski has not won in the Xfinity Series here at the World Center of Racing. Ty Dillon, not a bad rookie campaign, looking to get his sophomore season off on a good start. And there's a couple of veterans, Jeff Green, a series champion, and Eric Almirola, who won here last summer in the Sprint Cup Series. And you know Dale Jr. will be a player today. 6 times he has won the Xfinity Series here at Daytona. That is one behind the all-time leaders, his father, Dale Sr., and, of course, Tony Stewart, who both have won here on 7 different occasions. So we talked off the top about the rule changes for qualifying. With that, do we really know what to expect over the course of the next hour or so?
Yeah, I think you hear Chase Elliott. He's got a great plan, Phil.
I love his plan.
Let's just get in line and go. That's great, but there's going to be some other guys saying, excuse me, Mr. Elliott, I need to budge in here.
I don't have that champion's provisional.
My car's not that fast. If you could just get behind me, please, this will all work out swimmingly. But that's exactly where you have trouble. But what I love, Phil, what you don't want to do is qualify in the middle. You either want to be up front or maybe in the back. Guess where Regan Smith won the race from a year ago? Right dab in the middle. So you can win from anywhere on this track, and that's what makes qualifying so entertaining, because you have so many differing agendas.
And they line these cars up for qualifying by groups, just a random draw. So you may have the very fastest car here start in the back of the pack and the very slowest car start in the front of the pack in the same group. So there's a little bit of strategy going on. You want to get with your teammate. You want to get somebody that you can trust. So there's going to be a little gamesmanship going on at pit road. But NASCAR instituted a rule: once you go, you go.
Right.
You can go slow, but you have to, once you roll, you've got to go.
Keep rolling.
Exactly.
And you mentioned, Michael, 1 year ago here, Regan Smith started in the 19th position, but everything worked out for him just fine on that Saturday afternoon. You see him in the outside lane coming back to the checkered flag. Yes, he edges Brad Keselowski, his 2nd plate win in Xfinity Series competition in a couple of years for Junior Motorsports. They went on to sweep the season here. Casey Kane got the win for Junior in July. Let's hear from Regan. He's downstairs with Vince Welch.
Sorry, talking about a guy that's got some stuff going on. His wife is due any day now. He's going to run in the Xfinity Series race. Now he's going to fill in for Kurt Busch in the Sprint Cup Series. And, well, you're the defending champion here in this race. So how are you balancing it all? First of all, when did you first find out you were going to fill in for Kurt?
I didn't find out for sure till last night. So it was a little bit later on last night where we said, okay, this is what's going to take place. This is the plan. So certainly a good car on that side to be able to hop in. It's not every day that a car capable of winning the race opens up last minute like that. So we're going to do what we can on Sunday to make the most of that opportunity. But looking forward to today. We're going to make the most of the opportunity today, too. Hellman Chevy's fast, just like it was last year, and would love nothing more than to repeat and get the season started off the right way, get the points going the right way, and you know, who knows, if I could go out and win both races, maybe it'll send the wife into labor and I can get home just in time for that.
Yeah, that'd be a perfect play. Before we talk about repeating as the race champion, you got to qualify, and it's a different qualifying format. How do you approach it today?
I don't know. I started to watch the truck qualifying last night to really learn that and understand it, and that's when my phone started blowing up, so I didn't really get to watch the truck qualifying like I wanted to. I think we're just going to try and keep our car safe, and if that means we get through the next round and we qualify fifth, or if that means we qualify 35th, we're not going to worry too much about that. We're going to be smart with our race car, and there's a reason this one's the primary and the other one's a backup. We want to make sure we race our primary.
Good luck with everything on your plate. That's Regan Smith. Jamie?
Well, Vince, there's a lot of unknowns going into this qualifying round. And Ty, I saw you walk out here and you went straight to Dale Jr., who's in your group. What did you guys talk about, and are you coming up with some kind of plan?
Yeah, we're working on some stuff. You want to work together with the fastest cars. I know him and Junior Motorsports bringing quick cars, and we got some Chevys in line. So trying to get a good group. We did a good job of it yesterday in the truck practice or truck qualifying, and I feel like I got a good idea of what it's going to take to advance to each round. Just big on trying to make it to the final round, whatever it takes. So our Bass Pro Chevy's been really fast, and I'm excited to get back out there and get back on track and get in there for our first Xfinity race and maybe the first ones to win an Xfinity race.
He has one busy schedule, making his debut in his first Daytona 500 tomorrow. Guys?
Jamie, a triple header weekend for Ty Dillon, competing last night in the Camping World Truck Series, today in the Xfinity Series where he'll run for the championship, and as you said, tomorrow his debut run in the Great American Race.
Been a long time coming since I've seen your face. I've been everywhere and back trying to replace.
One of the great days in sports, the running of the Great American Race, tomorrow noon Eastern time on Fox, and proud to be sharing the booth today with a couple of guys that have won the Daytona 500. Michael Waltrip getting it done in 2001 and 2003, and later on Kevin Harvick will join us. Of course, he had that dramatic win here in 2007 when he edged Mark Martin, and now let's welcome in Vince from Pit Road.
And a busy weekend for Brad Keselowski, too. Let's see, last night you were truck team owner and your truck driver went to victory lane. Congratulations. How good did that feel as a truck team owner to see that?
Really good. I've never won a Daytona before, and I've been so close specifically in this nationwide series, Vince. I think I've run second two or three times. I've got a couple of thirds and fourths. I really thought it would come in one of these series, but I'll take it as an owner. That's great. I told everybody it's a win I didn't have to work for, but I lost a lot of money, but that's okay too. But having a lot of fun here, and this nationwide series, like I said, we've been so close with the discount tire Ford Mustang. Hopefully we can finish it out today, but first we got to qualify, and I really want to race this car this afternoon, so I need to not tear it up.
And he'll be last in the first group, so a pretty good draw for qualifying for Brad Keselowski. Jamie?
A lot of concern on Eric Almirola's face here. You're in the fourth group. What are you thinking, and what is your biggest concern?
I have like a million thoughts going through my head. My biggest concern is that this freshman Florida Ford Mustang doesn't have points to fall back on, and so I'm going to be the first car in my group. And if I go out there and do exactly what I'm supposed to do and just take off and leave pit road, that all the 11 cars behind me are going to get a tow off of me and that I'm going to be the slowest car in the group, and that there's a good chance that this car could go home, and I'm really nervous about that because it's not in my control. Like, there's nothing I can do other than just go out and leave pit road and see if I'm fast enough, and I'm concerned about that. But if I sit there and wait and don't get a lap in because of playing games, then that would certainly be disappointing as well. So I don't really know what to do. I don't like this new format. I don't like any of the formats. I don't know what NASCAR can do to make it better, but I'm really concerned that a really good race team like this and a really good car could potentially miss the race just because I'm going out there doing what I'm supposed to do, and I'm going to let 11 cars behind me go faster than me.
Eric Almirola, a lot on his plate, as you can hear, a lot of concern. It's going to be really interesting to watch how this all shakes out, Alan. Adam.
Here's what I would do. Don't do that.
Yeah, don't do that.
Don't be the first guy off. Just sit there. Make some guys will go. You know, he's got a great point. No points. We talked about differing agendas. Chase Elliott was as calm as I've ever heard anyone before qualifying. He said, we'll just get in line, get some laps in, and listen to Eric. He's all to pieces. Just fall back, sit there, don't get in a hurry, be a little bit patient, and let the line go around you.
He said he didn't like any format.
No. It's going to be hard to please that guy.
He'll just be glad when qualifying is over and he's in the show. Vince?
Jones, truck qualifying yesterday, did you gain anything from that that might help you with this format today?
Well, I don't know. It's kind of a free-for-all, whatever way you want to put it. So, I think it did help a little bit maybe with the mentality of it and trying to get some kind of plan formulated. So we don't have any teammates in our first group, but hopefully we'll be able to go out and get a good pull off somebody. I know the seven's out there and the nine, so there's some good cars out there that hopefully we can work together with. But got a good GameStop Camry. I was happy with it yesterday in practice. Just hope we can make it into the last round and have a shot at the pole.
18-year-old Eric Jones in the 20 car for Joe Gibbs. Adam?
And Vince, we were joking earlier about the maturity for Chase Elliott at 19. There's another kid that understands at a young age what it's all about. Eric Jones is going to be a player today. I'm going to be doing the Xfinity races all season long on Fox. You know, no one really cares about us, Michael.
Well, at least I know they don't care about me. The reason is because we got this cast of characters going to be joining us from now until June, and we announced yesterday Danica Patrick as well.
I'm looking so much forward to sharing the booth with these guys. Harvick has so much insight to the sport. Brad always has an opinion. And Jeff Gordon, experiencing his last year in Cup, is going to come to the Fox booth and be on the TV with us. That's awesome.
How about six combined championships for those drivers?
That's pretty good.
Pretty good.
Yeah.
Cup championships.
Absolutely.
And if you add me, that's still the number.
Here's a little team radio from Blake Koch as we get set for qualifying.
When they say go, we can't wait more than 10 seconds. So about 8 or 9 seconds, you're going to have to tell him.
I did the trucks yesterday, and we were very successful. So it's and we're going to have to probably change our plan each round. So we'll be good, I think.
I just don't want to overthink this. I want to be able to basically stay on that 25 or 88.
Yeah, you see the spotter was pretty confident. Said he spotted for truck qualifying yesterday and felt pretty good about it.
Mike Wallace is the first car off pit road, and everybody joins in behind Mike. It'll be interesting to see if he's comfortable with staying out in front. You know, he was the fastest car in our final practice yesterday. And I agree with Eric Almirola. You can't be the fastest car in this qualifying session if you come across the start-finish line first. There's just so much draft behind you, the other cars will make their way around you. So does Mike drag his feet a bit and hope they all go around him, or what's his strategy, you think, Phil?
I don't think you can drag your feet much because you really need to be up to speed when you come back around here. These guys can get about two laps. You see Brad Keselowski, that 22 car, joins that front two cars.
In between, that's the 52 of Joey Gase, giving Mike Wallace a push.
Watch Brad back off a little bit. He's trying to gap a little bit here so he can get a little bit of a run. He may pull down in front of those cars coming by on the inside.
Look at Mike Wallace. I think he's going to do the same thing. He's pulled to the inside. This other group's got to run. Wallace is making a smart move here. There's no way he could have gotten the pole by leading them to the line. And now, looks like is that Dakota Armstrong?
It is Dakota Armstrong, who won the pole here for the Xfinity race last July.
Now that second pack has a great shot of running a good second lap here. They weren't quite up to speed. We saw Mike Wallace get passed at the start-finish line. He wasn't quite up to speed, nor was Brad Keselowski, but they've got enough of a gap now. If they can get lined up, catch that front group on the second lap, it'll be a good one.
Yeah, you almost want to be dragging your feet a little bit still.
You don't want to catch them before you get to the start-finish line.
Right, and I think that's what Elliott Sadler might be doing back there.
Now we're coming down inside of 30 seconds. Everybody appears that they will get back across the start-finish line and have one more lap, and we'll see how it all shakes out as they cross the start-finish line this time around.
All right, let's guess. I think Elliott Sadler is the fastest in this group. What do you got, Phil?
That's what I think, too.
And Mike Wallace is possibly second fastest. Those, yep. Those cars are in a good position right now. These cars, all these cars in this draft, and including the last two, Elliott Sadler, will beat that front group. No doubt.
See, they tightened up a little bit. Brad Keselowski actually pushed that fourth car in line up to Joey Gase.
Right now, Joey Gase has to have a smile on his face.
He wedged himself right in the right spot.
He did. And, you know, you got to give Mike Wallace a lot of credit. He took off pit road fast, slowed down, got a group behind him. Mike Wallace orchestrated this pack, and that's a great pack.
I would say this isn't his first rodeo, but it is, because we've never done this before. They cross the start-finish line. Here comes the second group. And to the top, J.J. Yaley in the 28, and right behind him, that one car of Elliott Sadler.
They've scattered a little bit on this second lap, so
that's it.
Yeah, that's
going to
be
it. Mike Wallace ends up 12th.
Oh.
In group one, and remember, it's the top 24 overall, not six from each group in round one in advance. The top 24 overall speeds from our four groups that will go out in round one of qualifying. And now our monitor is updated, and yeah, J.J. Yaley is showing at the top in front of Sadler, then it's Clements, Armstrong, and Keselowski. One, qualifying is complete in the opening round here at Daytona for the NASCAR Xfinity Series. J.J. Yaley quickest, then it's Elliott Sadler, Jeremy Clements, Dakota Armstrong, Brad Keselowski, the top five, rookie Cale Connolly was sixth, and the biggest surprise for all of us in that opening group, Mike Wallace, fast yesterday in practice, but 12th in our opening group. Let's go to Jamie for the Geico Pit Report.
And Kyle Busch watched on there on the first round. Well, Kyle, what'd you learn there?
Some things.
Tell us a little something that you learned.
No, it just there's a plan, and you just got to learn based off what you see. And obviously, every group may be different, but based off what that first group did, you know, we've got to try to develop a plan so we can transfer through. And with our group, there seems to be a little bit of a separation maybe in some cars, and so we'll see how it plays out.
So your plan changed from the time you came out here to what you're going to do?
It did, actually. Yeah, it changed a little bit. You know, just with the timing and the way that you got to do all this stuff is a little particular. But, you know, hopefully it works. We'll see.
Definitely interesting. Kyle Busch looking for his first pole here at Daytona.
Okay, Jamie, and we heard earlier from Eric Almirola how nervous he was, and lots of nervous energy here. He's running around trying to get the scoop on how to handle things going forward.
Well, he was standing there watching with some of the other drivers from his group, Austin Dillon, Kyle Busch. They were all standing together because they are in the same group, and that looks like the three probably best funded cars in that fourth group. So they wanted to get together and try to get a game plan, because you can't do it by yourself here.
There's Eric talking to the Green brothers, both NASCAR Xfinity champions, David and Jeff. They've got a plan, I'm sure. And there's the captain down on pit road, Mr. Roger Penske. Ross Chastain there on his left, and Brad on the right. Everybody's interested. If nothing else, people are curious about how this is all going to turn out. What do we do? How do we get the pole?
And Brad's fifth quickest right now, but his time is not real fast. It's about 3/4 of a second off of J.J. Yaley, so that may not make it to the next round, depending on how these other groups go.
We've started the clock, the 2.5 minutes. For group two, and Landon Castle takes off quickly, and he's the only one that rolled off pit road right away.
He must have said, heck with this noise, I'm gonna go get my lap in and come back to the pit.
Some big names here in group two. Ty Dillon, who was top five in the championship a year ago, won in Indianapolis. Darrell Wallace Jr. running for rookie of the year. So is Daniel Suarez, driving for Joe Gibbs Racing. And the 42 of Kyle Larson are now all of them rolling off the pit lane as we've gone under 2 minutes.
And check that on Castle. He made it all the way off, too, and he's reduced his pace.
He's rapidly reduced his pace.
He's come up with a plan B already. And that's what this thing's all about. Oh, a little contact there. It was one of the cars pulled up to the outside, hit Dale Jr. in the back. That was Harrison Rhodes in the zero car that got in the back of Dale Jr. We ain't even on the racetrack yet. I talked about how if you're a slower car, you want to figure out how to get in front of people.
Yeah.
that's one way to do it.
Well, that's one way to do it. It's probably not the way I would advise doing it, but.
That contact was heavier than I thought. Yeah.
And look at these guys all scattered apart. Now, it'll be interesting to see if they can pull it all together. This lap isn't going to be any good. We know that. They're poised themselves for a good second lap. The slowest car on the track right now is the 01 of Landon Castle. He's just crossing the start-finish line in front of this pack. Everybody's got to go now, though, Phil.
We get two laps. That's all we're going to get.
I don't even know if they're going to get back for the second lap.
It's going to be tight. I mean, some of those guys were crossing the start-finish line at right around 50 seconds, and they weren't up to speed.
This group will get back around, led by Ty Dillon in that three car. He's got Bubba Wallace, the six, right behind him.
I don't think Dale Jr. is going to make it back. Look at this big run by Ty Dillon.
Got Bubba Wallace with him. Kyle Larson in that line. So is the rookie Daniel Suarez.
If they don't make it back, none of this group's going to transfer.
Under 10 seconds as they come off of turn four.
It's going to be extremely close.
Wow. Got to keep an eye on the flagman as well.
They're not going to make it. Oh, and, crash!
And the red and black flag was out. None of them made it back. And on top of that, the big one right here in the tri-oval.
Holy cow.
Remember, Landon Castle took off first. He's in it. Hard contact. There's Daniel Suarez, Blake Cook, the 8 car. Dale Jr. is able to drive through it.
Tanner Berryhill,
the 17.
Doesn't look like much damage to him.
And we got to keep in mind, we're going green here in a little over 3 hours at Daytona. So these crews, and you can see them running now down the pit lane, have got to get back to the garage, unload the backup, and be ready to go green in the season opener, like I said, in 3 hours and 20 minutes. And here's Kyle Busch, who says, there's 12 more. I really don't have to worry about.
Wow, that's tongue-in-cheek. I don't think he's clapping for that. See, that Carlos Contreras, that black car in the middle of the racetrack right there, was slow. And see, Kyle Larson's going to squeeze Blake Cook.
I think it
was actually Suarez
was trying to get through the middle, and he just misjudged the room he had to make that move and caused that crash. That was a rookie who was trying to understand exactly how to go about qualifying here at Daytona under this format, and was in a position, got himself in a position that he couldn't get out of. You could see he just cut up, clipped the front of Blake Cook's car, and caused the big crash.
Was trying to get in behind Kyle Larson in the 42 car. Didn't quite have the clearance.
And the irony is, none of them were going to get back and make a time.
That's it was within a couple seconds. They didn't know that, but you're right. That is the irony of the situation. They didn't do a very good job from the beginning, and the exclamation point was a huge crash at the end.
Mentioned the rookie, Daniel Suarez. Let's listen to his radio.
No, I mean, you were passing the car that the 42 jumped in line in front of, you know, so you were not clear. No, that 42 hopped in the hole and you were passing a car that was behind him.
He's right. He was not clear when he tried to pull up in line behind the 42.
And that's what we saw from up here. And
there's Blake Cook making his way to the ambulance.
Phil, we'll have to check the point standings, but some of these cars possibly won't make the race now.
Yeah, I totally agree.
Yeah, that'll be the difference for a lot of them. And we know there are 7 cars that will go home from today's qualifying session. 47 cars here this weekend, and only 40 make the race. Now, there were 2 cars from this group that actually jumped in front of those drivers that were in that opening group. Kyle Larson was 11th, Darrell Wallace Jr. in the 12th position.
There must have been another one too, because Wallace was 12th and he's 15th now. Who's the third car?
Let's hear from Kyle Busch, Jamie.
Well, we saw him clapping. I know he's disappointed. His own teammate, Daniel Suarez, involved in there and destroyed his race car. What's your impression of what you saw, and now what do you do?
I don't know. I can say a lot of things that get myself in a lot of trouble, but I would just say that this is not what we all intended, and this is not the plan. This is not what it needs to be. And somehow, some way, this just isn't right. We've got a bunch of torn up race cars, which we shouldn't be doing in qualifying, and
you've got guys now that may have speed. They may be fast enough to transfer through to the next round, but they're wrecked, so they can't transfer through. And one of the other cars you look at right now, Dale Jr., he may have had a good enough lap, but had to check up before the start-finish line, and now I don't think he's going to be fast enough to transfer through. So does he make the show? I don't know. I don't know the point situation on that car, but this just ain't right.
Some frustration down here. Let's go over to Vince.
Starting to feel a little sprinkle, actually, now down here on pit road. But with Brad Keselowski, what's your reaction to what we see and have seen throughout the weekend and some of these qualifying mishaps?
Yeah, you know, you just don't want to see cars wreck and qualifying. You know, the show is the race, so we want to make sure we don't lose sight of that. But then, you know, we've got a lot of people watching at home and want to give them the best product we can to watch. So trying to find the balance, right? And that's why I'm glad I don't have that job of trying to figure it out. But obviously there's some more work that needs to be done.
Yeah, tough call for sure. Adam?
Thanks, Vince. Well, let's go back and see what happened here. They were coming back down to the start-finish line. Red and black flags were out.
This is the first incident with a zero of Harrison Rhodes. He gets in the back of Dale Jr. in the 88 car.
That was a sign of what maybe we were to expect out of this group, because no one ever got going. Landon Castle was way ahead of the group. He slowed down, and these cars are all racing to get to the start-finish line to start their lap. Suarez makes a big move from the inside to the out, and there wasn't room for that move to be made. He gets clipped by Blake Koch, and around he goes.
Puts him into Carlos Contreras, the 15 car. Landon Castle with nowhere to go, right in the door of the 18.
Look at that Contreras car. It's tore all to pieces. And watch Tanner Berryhill slowly making his way through it. Can I survive it? Can I survive it? And just at the last minute, he got on the brakes, slid the front end, and made contact.
You know, we had group qualifying last year. They put all the cars out there for 25 laps. And we didn't have near this much carnage with all the cars on the racetrack. And what did we have, 12 cars on the race, 11 or 12 cars on the racetrack this time?
Wrecked half of them.
Yeah, maybe over half of them.
And we got two more groups to go in the opening round of qualifying, and you wonder how the mentality and plan will now change. A huge crash in group two of round one qualifying for the Xfinity Series here at Daytona, our coverage presented by GEICO. We're back after a break. First, we send it to Los Angeles, Jay and Dan. Two groups in to the opening round of qualifying for the NASCAR Xfinity Series here at Daytona. And all I can say is wow. The top 12 on your screen of what we've seen so far, only two of those coming from Group 2. That would be Kyle Larson and Darrell Wallace Jr. The other driver that ran quicker than those guys in Round 1, John West Townley. And you see the rest of the drivers that have been on track so far. And on top of everything we just had unfold on track, now we've got an unexpected rain shower over the Daytona International Speedway. The drama continues. Let's hear from Dale Jr., Vince.
Well, crazy indeed. We've got crashes on the track. We've got rain showers going on. Dale Jr. visiting with his crew chief, Dave Ellens. And, Jr., how do you put that in perspective of what happened out there?
I don't know. Guys just trying to get a fast lap in. Tore up a lot of race cars, and it's a shame before the race even starts.
A little bit seemed like maybe some contact with you just getting off pit road, was there?
Yeah, we were going off pit road, and the guys in front of me slowed down. I slowed down and said, you can't pass on the outside in turn one and two, and the guy behind me just plowed into me. So
very eventful, I guess that's the way to sum it up so far. Rain coming, cars starting to be covered, Adam.
And Vince, we just peeked at the radar here in the booth, and it's a small, small cell, but certainly has zeroed in on this 2.5 mile layout here in Daytona Beach, Florida. And so the wait will continue. And I'm guessing now the anxiety going to grow too, because not only do you have these drivers that were just involved in the crash that are now in jeopardy of missing today's race, but a lot of new teams, transfers of points. There are a lot of guys that may not even have their fate in their own hands when it's all said and done to making the race.
Yeah, and you guys have a race to run this afternoon, so they can't hold this qualifying session forever because they're going to have to get these cars ready to race. So there's a lot of anxiety, I'm sure, down on pit road. And the guys wondering if it rains out, are we in, are we out? And the guys that did not get a good lap there that know they have no points to fall back on, they're hoping for rain and maybe by some quirk of fate they'll be able to get in.
And you know, you made a great point, Phil. The race is coming up. This rain shower delays things. What if we have another session and another crash? Then you've got to get a backup car ready. Things just continue to get more and more complicated.
saw a quick shot of the storm clouds back behind the main grandstand here at Daytona.
It's going to pass through here. We're going to race. We know that. We just don't know who's going to race. Remember the top of the show, that young man right there? We're just going to pull off, get in line, and go. Well, that's exactly the opposite of what happened in Group 2. Landon Cassel tore out and then slowed down. All the other drivers drug their feet trying to figure out how to get behind other cars. When they came to the start-finish line to run their fast lap, they didn't even get here in time. They weren't even going to get a lap anyway, and we have that crash.
The jet dryers have now fired up here on the main straightaway at Daytona, so we'll try to get this track dried up. And to put a little perspective on time, the race this afternoon on Fox Sports 1, scheduled to go green about 3 hours from right now, 3:50 Eastern time. So we've got a little bit of time to work with, and obviously NASCAR will take an assessment on how long it takes to dry Daytona. There is a nice breeze. Temperatures are warm, so I think they can get this place dry in relatively quick fashion. But we still got a long way to go, and I guess the one piece to this puzzle, too, is NASCAR could, and we saw them call some audibles last year, where maybe you do all your qualifying is a part of one group. I realize these group sessions aren't very long, but in the interest of time, this format does allow you the opportunity to call a little bit of an audible when it comes to qualifying.
They may say, let's let group 3 and 4 go, and then we're going to call that good. We're going to call that the entire qualifying session. We know that won't take long to do that.
Vince?
With Bubba Wallace, he was in that second group. It's been pretty eventful so far, hasn't it? What's your take on that?
It was. This whole new deal is kind of interesting for everybody. Hate to see some torn up race cars, but glad we were able to get through it. So got a little dicey there towards the end. I don't know who me and Ty went around, but I wasn't going to lift to give up any momentum, that's for sure. But I hope our time holds up. The rain came through, so it's kind of luck right now. But good thing is we have a really good 40 GoBoost Mustang for the race. So we can just get that far, get the rain away, go have some fun a little bit later. But this is fun. Glad to be back here at Daytona. Blood's pumping. Don't want to see any torn up stuff, though.
I know it's early in the going, first race of the season, but how's been your experience been so far with Roush as you've moved over to that team?
It's been a lot of fun. My guys are all a young group of guys. We have a lot of fun with each other. So Chad's the crew chief. He's the youngest crew chief I've had. So it's different there, but we're gelling. We're vibing pretty good. So I'm excited about that. We got a bright, bright future, bright season ahead of us. So couldn't be more proud to carry the Ford EcoBoost colors this weekend and represent Roush Fenway well.
Yeah, Bubba Wallace, certainly one of those young guns, one of the most talked about drivers in the NASCAR series.
One of two new faces over in the Roush organization, Vince. Elliott Sadler, a veteran, moving over from Joe Gibbs Racing as well. Should be fun in that camp in 2015. Continue around Daytona International Speedway. It's NASCAR Xfinity Series qualifying presented by GEICO with Michael Waltrip and Phil Parsons. I'm Adam Alexander. Thanks for spending part of your Saturday with us. And if you're just joining us, we just about, I guess we did officially get through two groups of round one of qualifying. And the second one full of drama as they were coming back to the start-finish line.
Well, they never even got off pit road before we had drama.
That's exactly right. Harrison Rhodes hits Dale Earnhardt Jr., and then everyone had made a lap, but we knew that wasn't the fast lap. The money lap was coming. No one got back to the start-finish line, and therefore we sit and wait, because now, added to all the mess that we had on the front straightaway after the accident, we have rain showers in Central Florida. Let's listen to a little team audio here from moments ago. It's Carlos Contreras.
It kind of started raining a little bit, just a little bit harder again, just off and on.
Yeah, I'm just listening to NASCAR here on the side. I mean, just like I said, get your nap in.
I'm going to get me a nap, and if you were up on the roof, you were going to get a bath.
No, I'm all good.
So taking a little time to rest here, and now you look into the Xfinity Series garage, and that's Daniel Suarez and his team going to work to try to get the backup car ready. And these teams are going to have a quick turnaround here, Jamie.
And I was told that 18 car, by the way, got the 11s points from last year, so he should be good, and that's why they're going to the backup. Meanwhile, I'm joined by Brian Scott. You're supposed to be in this next group, and there's a lot of talk down here. You know, what should we do? If you were NASCAR, what would you do?
I don't think that it rained enough for us to lose the track. I think that maybe a pass or two with the jet dryers will be good to go. Me personally, I'd like to qualify our Shore Lodge Chevrolet. I think it's going to be fast. I think we can get a good qualifying time, maybe have a shot at the pole here. And I think the rain's done. I think the sun might even poke back out of these clouds, and this may be a temporary delay.
You were very optimistic. So you just watched two groups go out in round one. What did you learn?
We learned what not to do. I'm not sure we've learned what to do yet with this new format in the first session having four groups. But we have a plan, and trial and error. We at least saw what you don't want to be doing, and that's wrecking your primary car. The most important thing is to race your best piece, and we feel like this Shore Lodge car right here, this is our best super speedway car, so we don't want to wreck it in qualifying. We'd rather start at the back than put ourselves in harm's way.
All right, Brian Scott coming up in the next group.
And we hope at some point Brian gets on track and we can continue qualifying. And here you see Landon Castle's car is in the garage and they're trying to get it set up and pull out the backup. And then you got Blake Cook there in a similar situation for TriStar Motorsports. And now we look at the list of drivers in Group 3. And I'll tell you what, some big stars when you talk about the guys that will go out here.
Yeah, here you go. You got an RCR car right there. You've got a couple JR Motorsports cars right here. You've got a Roush Fenway car. You've got a Joe Gibbs car. You got another Roush Fenway car, another RCR car. So you've got a lot of strong cars in this group. When I saw the groupings, I said, this third group is going to be the one.
And then you've got some guys that quite frankly, their cars aren't that fast, and they don't have that much super speedway experience.
But so they got to get in, though. They got to get in.
And what they're going to do is attempt to wedge their way in between those fast cars. And that's what makes this qualifying so difficult. Somebody's got to lead the pack. And those slower cars are going to try to get in between fast cars, because the fast cars on each end of a slow one, the one in the middle doesn't know it's slow. It's just honking right down the straightaway.
You know, I think I'm going to blame Mike Joy for all this, because when we walked in here following Sprint Cup practice, he said, you know, those clouds over there, they've got rain in them. And here we sit. Thanks, Mike. We were doing a little analysis here of the 24 cars that have been out, where their speeds and times are, and looking then at the 24 cars that will still go out. And there's going to be a lot of drama unfold here in the next little bit once we get this track dry. And one of the guys that will be a part of it, Ryan Reed, Vince.
And he is in that next group, just discussing a little bit of strategy. How did you, from what you've seen in these first two groups, develop a strategy for what you're going to try to employ here in this third group?
Well, I'm really lucky. You know, I got Chris Busch, my teammate in our group, so obviously whatever he does, I'm going to try and do and work with him. But I think we have a pretty strong group with Chase and the two, and there's a few other guys in our group that are really strong. So hopefully we can all group up and go work together and not do what those guys just did. I mean, I think that's the important thing, is stay out of trouble. You know, I mean, we all have fast race cars, so we need to be I want to run this car in the race, not a backup car. So I think we have a good opportunity to get ourselves in the top 24 and progress into the next round. And if we can do that, then I think we'll have a shot to be a little more aggressive the next round. But here it's just about getting in a few solid 3-4 laps with a good group and go from there.
Anything surprise you from what you've seen in those first two groups?
You know, I thought last round, you know, as they went out there and started going slow and playing some games, and you only have 2.5 minutes. So, I mean, to me, you got to just go, you know. I mean, I know you're trying to get a toe off the pack in front of you, but you don't have time to set that up. And if that doesn't come to fruition, you're going to have to just go. I think that you're better off to go run 2 or 3 hard laps at speed in one pack than try and be towing off another pack and only get one lap. So that's my opinion. And you put yourself in a bad position like those guys did if it doesn't work out, and then there's cars going, you know, 20 mile an hour slower, and that's how wrecks start. So, my goal is to not have any of that happen with us and get in a good pack and go.
Well, there's the plan. We're about to see how it plays out, Adam.
Thanks, Vince. And looking around the track and the progress that's being made, the speed of the jet dryers has picked up, which tells me that they're not overly concerned about the moisture on the track right now that they're trying to move. I think we're pretty close to being able to go here with Group 3 in Round 1.
Yeah, the sky certainly brightened up here, so I think we're going to be in pretty good shape here momentarily. And as you mentioned, we have a little bit of time. We're probably now, 2.5 hours till race time. They're about 3:30, so I think there is time. Now, it doesn't mean there's going to be any more time for the guys that wrecked, but obviously, you know, they wrecked and they're going to have to work on those backup cars.
That's one busy man right there.
I just hope he gets in.
I'm surprised he hasn't come up here and talked to us in the booth, because he's talked to everybody on pit road.
He's fresh, and he's athletic, and he used all those skills to talk to just about everybody on pit road about his plan. You know, that shows you how important this just being in the show is. And that's why you get such differing strategies. Guys like Ryan Reed, who says, let's just go, and Chase Elliott, the same comments. But then Eric is saying, we got to go, but I can't go first. Someone else has to do that.
Now he's talking to Joe Nemechek. Joe's not even in his group when he's talking to him. So he's already exhausted all his group.
I think he's just venting now.
Busy on that spotter stand as they communicate and try to put together some form of a plan. And I agree with what Ryan Reed was telling Vince a moment ago. You can't wait too long. And I think we will see this next group get with the program as soon as the green flag is given. They will move on out of there and get things rolling, because, as he said, you only have 2.5 minutes. And under these circumstances, you don't want to jeopardize not making the race later today. We think we're getting close to putting 2.5 minutes on the clock and going with Group 3, Round 1 qualifying for the Xfinity Series here at Daytona International Speedway. And when we get going, some pretty big names on our list for Group 3.
Yeah, there really are. And I think this is the strongest group for sure. And we talked to a couple of those drivers. Brian Scott talked to Ryan Reed. And I think, and Chase Elliott early on, I think they just need to get in line and go. And, again, I think where the speed would fall in, if they would just get in line and go, I think they would be in good shape as far as advancing to the next round.
Especially since we lost so many cars out of round
exactly.
two. That gives them a little bit of cushion there. You can see Group 4 here. Austin Dillon, a really strong car in this group, along with Kyle Busch and Eric Almirola. Those are three really good cars, and the rest of those cars are a little bit marginal on speed, so it'll be interesting to see how Group 4 forms up and what kind of time they're able to put on the board.
Vince?
With Elliott Sadler, and he's in a good position right now, currently P2, and we're just kind of talking about some of the pros and cons of this qualifying format, and where do you stand on it?
Where I stand on it, we have to do as a sport what's good for the fans in the stands, and also for you guys, all the Fox Sports 1 fans at home. And I think this format, NASCAR is working on it, tweaking on it, but I think this format is good for our sport. I think it brings excitement to qualifying. Yes, it does have its downsides when you have accidents like this that can be avoided. But honestly, for the good of the sport, I like this format.
Is the responsibility placed more in the hands of the drivers then for some of the incidents that we've seen?
Well, my opinion, which is one of millions, I think you got a lot of these young drivers out here, and their crew chiefs are in their head, and their engineers are telling them, you got to do this, you got to do that, you got to lay back, you got to side draft. And they're not really focusing on what they're doing and looking ahead and being a driver. You got 10 people trying to drive the car for qualifying instead of just one. And I think if the crew chiefs will stay out of it and let the drivers just go down the line and drive and draft, it'd be a lot easier and a lot less stuff torn up. But I think you got too many guys trying to outthink the system, and then you have issues because of that.
Yeah, very complicated, that's for sure. The good news for Elliott Sadler is that his car is still in one piece, and he's currently P2 on the board. Let's go to Jamie.
Well, Daniel Suarez is one of those young guys just making your third start now. What is it like for you to come to this place, Daytona of all places, and qualify in this type of format?
Well, it's good. It's the same for everyone, and it's something different, and everyone is trying to figure it out, but definitely something more difficult because, as everyone knows, we just have a couple laps to make the good lap. So everyone was waiting in the back straightaway to try to make at least one good lap, and everything was really well, but I think Kyle Larson, Ty Dillon, and someone else was in that group of cars, and I was there as well. We had a very good run, and I don't know, someone from the slow car start to slow down a lot, and I tried to make a run, and then I run out of room and I wrecked. So it's just bad luck. I believe that. I mean, block he's okay, but in the race, in the second part of the race, but in qualifying it's not the moment to start blocking, because the only thing we can gain is either wreck or gain few positions. So,
well, it's a lot of pressure on this team. They only have 3 hours from the time of this incident to get this backup car ready for the race. But he will make it, Adam.
Adam, we had roughly 12 cars on the track and had a half of them pile up. What's this afternoon going to look like when old Kevin Harvick comes up here and helps us dissect what all is going to go on when you put all 40 of them out there together and throw a bunch of prize money and a big trophy from Daytona? into the picture?
I was going to say, that's actually going to be a race. It's not qualifying just to get into the race.
You know, and I respect Elliott Sadler's a cagey veteran. He's won in the Cup Series. He's raced for championships in the Xfinity Series. And I agree with everything he said. You understand how difficult it is to go out there and do this job. And then you got young rookies that are getting a lot of pressure to make moves that they're not ready to make yet. And I think Elliott said that well.
Eric Almirola is from Florida. Last time we raced here, he won. His sponsor is fresh from Florida. And based on how he's handled this qualifying session, I think he might be running for governor of the Sunshine State. He's politicking with everybody. A little time with Austin Dillon and Kyle Busch.
There's the Green brothers.
Yeah.
A couple of crew guys. There he is talking to Jeff Green by Jeff's car.
He must not have trusted what Jeff said when David was there, so he pulled him aside, talked to Jeff by himself.
More of Austin's crew right there. Now hanging out with Joe.
You think he's giving or getting advice there from Joe Nemechek?
I think it's just a conversation at this point. He's been all over the place. He just needs somebody to talk to. He needs a friend.
He needs a hug.
If he doesn't, Joe's in the car. He can't figure it out.
Joe's not a bad guy to talk to, though. He's one of the five drivers entered here this weekend. They have an Xfinity Series win at Daytona. Track looks good. Hopefully we'll be going green again soon. NASCAR Xfinity Series qualifying. And sometimes when it comes to racing, the plan does not go as scheduled. That would be the case here. Big wreck at the end of Group 2 and Round 1 qualifying, followed by a rain shower. We sit and wait. And while we do, we remind you of what's straight ahead here on Fox Sports 1. Following our qualifying coverage, we go back to our studios in Charlotte. It's a weekend edition of NASCAR Race Hub. 3 o'clock, race day for the Xfinity Series season opener here at Daytona. And shortly after 3:30, we'll put the green flag in the air for the first race of 2015. Looking forward to having Kevin Harvick in the booth with Michael and myself. And Jamie will be on pit road. In fact, she's there right now. What's up, Jamie?
Hey, Adam. Well, Chase Elliott's had the right idea. He's been sitting in this car for about 45 minutes through the rain and everything. Kyle was over here for a bit talking to you. What were you guys talking about?
Anything and everything, I guess. So I figured it was dry, so I might as well sit in here. But talking about short track racing and late model cars, and we both have a pretty good interest in racing those kind of cars whenever we can. So talking a little bit about that, and just kind of waiting on everything to dry up so we can go qualify.
You were pretty calm and cool and collected when I talked to you before all of this happened. Now that we've seen a couple of rounds go out, what are your thoughts about your round?
It is what it is, I guess, is the best way to put it. The thing you got to understand is this is all for a starting spot, you know, and we still have an entire race to run. So, if we can just get through this qualifying session and hopefully not tear anything up, I think that will be a success. So wherever you qualify here, it really doesn't matter at the end of the day. So just trying to make sure you put yourself in the right positions throughout the race is the most important thing. It's much easier said than done, but a nice starting spot would be good to have if we can get it, but if not, it's not the end of the world. So we know that, and we're just trying to be smart about it, and we have a strategy we're going to go about. It's not the most complex thing. We're just going to go make two laps, and wherever we end up, we end up.
Chase Elliott, as always, keeping things in perspective here.
He is Steady Eddie. I mean, his heart rate really never changes. And, you know, we would have had a great championship battle last year if not for Chase. I mean, second to fifth, separated by 23 points. He had to go and stink up the show in his rookie season.
And, you know, when he showed up at Daytona last year for his rookie season, no one really knew exactly what to expect out of this young man. How could he go out and be the favorite for the championship? But from the beginning, he proved he was ready. His victory at Texas was impressive to me, but when he went to Darlington, made those moves late in the race and grabbed that win at that very tough racetrack, that showed me that young man is the real deal.
And the drivers that he was able to beat to get those wins, too.
About 20 months ago, he won that road course race in the Truck Series in Canada. Didn't know what his plans were. I think it's all worked out. His plan now is to go qualify. He'll do it next. On board with defending series champion Chase Elliott, let's go down to Vince Welch.
Is that a Boy Scout troop?
Yeah, how about that?
Wow,
yeah.
Nice.
J.J. Ehler. Hey, it's good to see your name on top of the board, and you're going to go on to round two. You like this super speedway racing, don't you?
Well, I don't know if I like it, but it is a lot of fun. Obviously, there's a lot of different characteristics that go to it, and
You know, we switched this JGL car up to a Toyota Camry this year, and it's a huge improvement. You know, I spoke with Elliott before we went out there and just said, hey, I know the way this is going to kind of work out. I know we're at the back of the pack. Whatever you do, I'm going to push you because I know that's going to be our best chance. You know, I even expressed that to Keselowski, but I think he was on his own agenda. And it just worked out well for me that, you know, as we were coming to the line, that Elliott caught the back of the pack and let me make up another car length on him. And again, be top of the board now, which, you know, I don't know if that's going to be good enough to be there at the end of these rounds. But again, we have to move on, which is good for us.
Yeah, well done. Adam.
Yeah, and we did the math. I mean, 23 cars remaining, so JJ has definitely locked himself in to round two. And we were talking and kind of handicapping what's left. I mean, it's going to be interesting to see, of the speeds we've seen so far, how many of those hold up and move on.
I'm going to unofficially lock Elliott Sadler in as well. His speed's just about as fast as Yaley. And if you're looking back through the top 10, 12 cars, the times are so close there, it'd be really hard to put one guy in and take another guy after that out, because it's just going to be within a hundredth of a second or so, Phil.
Yeah, I think right now, I would say Jeffrey Earnhardt in eighth, to me, he would be safe, because I really don't think all 23 remaining cars are going to beat his time. So yeah. I think I would lock him in right now at eight.
That's a good guess.
And I'd say there's a bunch of them in this group that will move on to round two, because we got
green.
Some heavy hitters.
All right, let's see the plan.
Well,
okay,
it's so green.
So far, I see the plan.
Did have a 44-minute red flag following group
no
two.
No one is rolling.
Because of the rain.
Everyone is rolling.
Now you're getting started to get help. Everyone's rolling.
Chase just said, I'm going to go.
The heck with this.
I'm going to go, and y'all come along.
And reading the body language of the way he pulled out, he's a little bit frustrated with all this, huh?
Well, he's locked in. He's the champion. He knows he's going to race. There's other cars in that group that aren't. So I understand everyone's frustration and also everyone's plan. They gotta make the plan that's right for them. Now, if Chase goes, it'll be interesting.
Scott Legacy, the 19 car, who had a great run last night in the truck race. Top five finish for Scott.
Chase kind of drug his feet a bit there, made sure he tightened the pack up. Still don't think he's up to speed, Phil.
He's not up to speed for sure.
See Joe Nemechek, Bobby Gearhart closing in the 87 and the 85, and behind them leading that next group around, the two of Brian Scott. Be right around 1 minute when they come back here to the start-finish line.
I think they are getting up to speed now, so that means...
Sorry, it does not work, but we'll see.
See, you can slow down all you want, but the people in the back have the ability to do like you see the last two cars have done, gap themselves to the leader, and they will run a faster time than Chase does in the front, because they'll make up that ground that they're behind. Unless they have to pass a car, which looks like they're going to do right now, that can put a little hitch in their plan. But to the bottom they go, and around they go.
And we all believe the second lap is going to be fastest. They came across the start-finish line to start their first lap with roughly a minute left on the clock. So no problems getting back around here to the start-finish line and getting what you believe will be the money lap here in Group 3.
Bobby Gearhart in that white car, fourth in line, he's the one that hopefully will get a little bit of tow. He's going to have to qualify his way in on time. Maybe he can get a little bit of tow off these front three cars.
And you can see they've got more ground to make up than Regan Smith does back there in that yellow car. But as they make up the ground on the three cars ahead of them, Regan will continue to reel in the group of six between he and the front. So I like where Regan Smith's sitting right now in this group.
And he was the quickest one on that opening lap here in Group 3, and right behind him, Eric Jones.
Bobby Gearhart has a good car behind him. He has Brian Scott behind him. It looks like they've gained a little bit of ground. There's Chris Buescher, the 60. Is he going to pull out to pass?
I don't think I'd have done that.
I think that's a mistake.
I don't think I'd have done that.
If he would have stayed in line, he obviously would have been faster than those three cars, because he would have closed the gap. Now he just pulled out of line and just ruined his lap.
A dozen cars back to the start-finish line.
Whoa, they're wrecking. Holy cow, they tried to wreck again.
Brian Scott was turned sideways.
Eric Jones, Regan Smith to the top from this group.
Oh,
You can't get sideways in the tropical like that, not raft, scared to death.
How about Justin Marks jumps all the way up to fifth. Ryan Reed in the top 10. Brendan Gaughan is there. And you guys talked about Chris Buescher. He is now eighth overall as we have wrapped up three groups in round one.
And Bobby Gerhart, 28th quickest. If he would have stayed in line, Michael, he would have been somewhere, I think, up in the top 15.
But 28th quickest for Bobby Gerhart, 29th for Mario Gosselin, bumps Dale Earnhardt Jr. all the way back to the 30th spot.
J.J. Yaley, Elliott Sadler, 1-2 in the opening group. Now third and fourth overall. And, Michael, we were all anxious when they were coming down to the start finish line, courtesy of Brian Scott. Here's a replay.
Oh, man, I was a nervous wreck when I saw this car turn.
Brian said all he wanted to do was keep his primary. Just about lost it right there.
And you
Chris
know,
Buescher, the 60, right behind him.
The great job he did. You saw him correct his car, but he was already correcting it back the other way before he even caught it. That's an experience move there. He knew if he kept it turned to the right, he would whip back up in front of traffic. Brian Scott made an amazing move there not to jet right back up in the middle of that mess.
We talked about this being a very strong group. Six of our top eight times so far came out of this group.
And by the way, the guy that led that group, Chase Elliott, he's 26th. And the guys in the back of that same group are at the top of the chart. That's what's so difficult about this format. When you go out first, you don't have a prayer.
13 cars remain. That's how many will be in our final group here in round one. Joe Nemechek, who has a win here at Daytona in the Xfinity Series, is on the bubble. Scott Lagasse Jr., Phil talked about so good last night in the Camping World Truck Series race, on the outside looking in. Daniel Suarez, Chase Elliott, Dale Earnhardt Jr. among that group as well.
We speculated Brad Keselowski, fifth quickest after the first group, that may have been in danger, but right now 11th with 11 cars to go.
13, and he's locked, so that's good.
Yes, sir. And an amazing save by Brian Scott. Saved us from having another major crash at the start-finish line. Well, now all the planning and all the work that we saw Eric Almirola doing down on pit road, let's see how it all turns out. He has just watched Group 3 go, one of the fastest cars in Daytona. Chase Elliott led that pack off pit road. He qualified 26th.
And Eric lines up first. So we know that he's not going to want to stay there. He's going to try to get behind some of his friends.
He can't risk going out first and not being able to draft up and get a fast time. He has no points.
So here come the 11 cars that will make up our final group in round one. Let's go back and listen to what Chris Buescher was saying there as we wrapped up group three.
I'm like 95% sure I did not hit the two there coming through the trioval. I don't know exactly what happened, but I'm almost positive. I was close to him, but
I'm gonna say I'm 90% sure you did.
It wasn't much, but it doesn't take much when you're running speeds. And that, believe me, that trioval is not a straightaway. It's banked.
He might have told him like Jay McMurray told Greg Biffle the other night, my car did get loose when you jacked my rear wheels off the ground. That'll happen.
What's going on, Vince?
With Kyle Larson currently 18th on the chart, is it possible to have a plan and then go out and execute it as we look ahead at this fourth and final group?
Every time I've had a plan at a super speedway during qualifying, it never worked out. So I just went out there and you know, didn't expect much, but I think we'll be close to making the next round. So it doesn't really bother me if we don't make it, because there'll probably be more carnage for sure. So our Ineos Chevy's, you know, pretty fast. I thought in the draft yesterday, had good speed. So like I said, if we don't make the next round, I'll be perfectly fine with that.
I think he's still going to be competitive in the race this afternoon. That's for sure. Kyle Larson, Adam.
Right now, 18th overall is Kyle Larson, Vince, with 11 cars still to go, and they have pulled down to the end of pit road, and it won't be long before group four is out and making their run.
How many times do you hear race car drivers predict carnage in qualifying? That's exactly what Kyle Larson just said. He says probably gonna be carnage anyway, and we're just a couple hours away from race time. Certainly interesting situation these guys find themselves in. No more interesting than what Eric Almirola is faced with right now.
Do you think once we set the top 24, do you think they'll calm down a little bit?
No. Do you?
No, absolutely not.
There's going to be a lot of desperation in this group, guys.
There are the 11 drivers, and they waste no time. Track is open. There they go.
They waste no time pulling off. Watch Eric Almirola drag his feet. There you have it.
33, Austin Dillon won the championship a couple of years ago. Going to run 20 races for Richard Childress Racing this season.
Eric's going to let a few more go. He has Kyle Busch right now, two cars behind him. Eric's going to jump up. I think he wants to be right there.
I think he's happy. He's got a car beside him, though. Will he let that car squeeze in?
I don't think he has any choice. I'm not sure he wanted that. As Jeff Green behind him in the 10 car.
That's Chris Cockrum that went around him. So not two blazingly fast cars. Hopefully fast enough to keep up, because Almirola's got himself a nice little gap there.
I think he played it about right. As good as you can by being the number one guy sitting down there on the pit lane.
Well, he's going to catch his 13 car too fast. I think he's going to have to pass
this. Push him.
He's going to push him.
Can't lock to him, yeah. But you can bump him. Kyle Busch swings to the outside.
I think he's just giving up. Kyle's just giving this up.
I think he's saying, I know I can get back around for another lap. I'm going to fall to the back and pull up on these guys. This is his strategy to get the pole. He pulled out of line, moved to the back, and now he's going to make a run on these guys on the next lap.
And look at the gap right there. The gap has to be right, and you can't catch them too quickly. You catch them too quickly, then we have the carnage that we had in group two.
And Eric Almirola has pushed the 13 of Chris Cockrum right back to the back bumper of the car ahead of him.
Top 24 overall speeds from round one. Move on to round two. Joe Nemechek on the bubble right now, and here they come down to the start finish line to start recording times in this, the fourth and final group of the opening round. All of them on the right side of our scoring monitor, so no one has jumped up inside the top 24, but we know this is the money lap.
And right now Eric Almirola is 33rd. They will lock in 33 on time.
But he can't get beat by another car in this group.
We got Kyle Busch in 40th, and we know Kyle's going to make some ground up on that group behind, in front of him. Or at least we feel like he will.
He might be too far back, Phil, all by himself, but he looks like he's closing a bit. This will be a faster lap for Almirola, too, so they'll pass some of the cars that were in the groups before. So I think he's pretty safe right now if they can just make it back without scaring the crap out of us again.
Austin Dillon leading the charge through the tri-oval. Everybody passes the start-finish line clean. Eric Almirola jumps up to 15th. Ross Chastain jumps up to 9th there. Jeff Green in the 11th position. All these drivers that were on track in Group 4. Austin Dillon, 21st. Among the others that had a nice lap, Ryan Seeing is there. And Mike Harmon, 23rd overall.
Kyle Busch all the way back in the 32nd spot. Dropping to the back was his strategy. It didn't pay off. He didn't have enough of a run on that group ahead of him to get there, but some great runs by Dexter Beam locking himself in. John West Townley, we talked about him earlier, he's in. Joey Gase, some cars that really needed the speed to get in, got it.
How about Derek White? He got the last spot on time, 33rd quickest.
Edging out Ty Dillon, who's 34th.
So the opening round of qualifying determines who will make the field and also determines how they will line up. From 25th on back, the top 24 advance, and all those drivers still eligible for the pole. Longer than expected, but round one of qualifying is complete for the Xfinity Series here at Daytona. Eric Jones, the quickest of the bunch, top 24 speeds overall, advancing to round two.
Chris Cockrum doing a nice job there. Last guy to make it in. Mike Harmon in as well, guys that had to go.
Josh Rayum.
Rayum's one of those guys that had to go, and he did it.
Ryan Sieg, two top 10 finishes here last year in the Xfinity Series.
And, you know, don't be surprised if old Ryan Sieg surfaces at the top of the list, at the top of the running order at some point.
Right,
tomorrow.
There's the cutoff on speed right there. The top 33 make it on speed. Derek White gets that last coveted spot.
Ty Dillon will use a provisional to get in.
So will our defending champion, Chase Elliott, and the rookie, Daniel Suarez.
Dale Jr., the points came over from the 5 car. They've renumbered that 5 car, the number 88 this year. Ran full-time last year as the number 5. A
Let's go back and look at Brian Scott. And the moment he had, this was at the end of Group 3, coming down to the end of their session.
This scared the heck out of me. What did it do to him, you think, Phil?
I don't know. Let's have Jamie ask him what it did to him.
How's he feeling about it, Jamie?
Well, he just watched that back along with us. And Chris Buescher said he swears he did not touch you there. How did you save it?
Sometimes you'd rather be lucky than good. In those situations, it's kind of a hero or a zero move because you got it correct. Sometimes they hook and you go into the outside wall. Just got lucky. Luckily, you know, the contact or whatever got me sideways, and then it was off, and I kind of had some room to do what I needed to do with the car. You don't always get that at super speedways. We're lucky. We're lucky, and now we're moving on. So we'll go out there and have a little more excitement, and hopefully don't have a moment like that again.
He also told me with twice as many cars in this next round, that should be a better thing for him, Vince.
In that mix as well and narrowly avoided it. How hectic is it out there in this qualifying format?
I mean, we kind of sat with the 60 and knew that we were just going to try to help push him in because he didn't have points. And so we felt pretty comfortable with the group we had. We'd be fast. Right there, though, right before I hit that dog leg, I could see water being pushed by somebody, and I felt our group tightening up, and I went, I want to get out of here. So I, as soon as I started my move up, I took the shot from the 16, and whatever happened. I pulled our South Point Chevy out of the way, and I'm pretty happy about it.
How important is this next round for you, considering what you're going to have the opportunity to do this afternoon in the race?
Well, you know, at Daytona, you can qualify anywhere still, but it's Daytona, and we're already in the second round. We know we have ECR horsepower. We know we have great aero. So I got to look at who's in our group. You know, this whole deal right now depends on who's in your group, who's pulling it, who's pushing it. So I'm not into playing the games. I did see, I thought Kyle was going to be brilliant for a second, it looked like, but I guess it didn't work. But so we'll see who's in our group, and we're just going to go and do the same thing, try to play it as straight as we can. We have enough horsepower under the hood and enough aero that we should be fast regardless.
Adam?
And Vince, we hear from Brendan Gaughan, who moves on, and these are the drivers that not only did not move on, but they failed to qualify for the season opener. Harris Rhodes running a third car for JD Motorsports this season, unable to get it done. And Scott Lagasse, that's a heartbreaker.
And a lot of those guys, insult to injury, their cars are tore all to pieces as well. So
many of them involved in that crash there at the end of Group 2 in our opening round. So 24 advance. We'll get to those on track when we continue on Fox Sports 1. The NASCAR Xfinity Series is back. We're glad to have it and also happy to have some star-studded guests joining us in the booth. Today it's Kevin Harvick, Jeff Gordon going to be with us this season, Brad Keselowski, and we found out yesterday that Danica Patrick going to join us as well. Race Hub follows our qualifying session. Then it's NASCAR Race Day for the Xfinity Series coming up at 3. And we go green shortly after 3:30 here at the World Center of Racing.
I can't wait, man. I love having Harvick up here. He's a former champion of this series. He's the reigning Sprint Cup champion. He has opinions. He'll have observations and views, and it's going to be fun hanging out with the champ.
I'm looking down here on pit road, and so the opening round, the four groups are determined by a random draw. But once you move on to round two, the cars line up. Quickest to slowest, odd for group one, even for group two. So Eric Jones, who is number one on the board, is first in line on the pit lane. Vince?
Josh Rayome qualified in the top 24, but you've decided not to go out for the second round. Why?
Yeah, well, I mean, starting, we qualified 22nd. The worst we're going to start is 24th, so it just doesn't really make sense for us to risk wrecking our car. I mean, it's crazy. I was pretty nervous when I was out there. The guys are just all over the place, so. We're really happy we made the show. I can't thank Mr. Victor Obika enough for giving me the opportunity to run the car. We're going to run the whole season. So just a really, really, really thankful, really blessed, and really just so happy we made the show. I was feeling a lot of pressure. I think the lap that got me in was like my seventh lap around Daytona, period. So I'm really happy we made it in.
Yeah, you've seen a lot of frowns down here, Alan. Adam, it's good to see one with a smile on his face.
Yeah, the Redlands, California native, comes all the way to Daytona, and he gets to race with all the big guns. That's a cool story.
How fun was that interview? He's happy. It's fun to see somebody happy after we've seen so much frustration during these qualifying sessions.
And we saw yesterday during Truck Series qualifying, some of the guys that advanced a round of 24 decided not to run, not take a chance.
This is interesting. That's the most gap we've seen drivers put between the first cars onto the track. But, you know, Phil, we know Eric Jones is going to go out on the track and run slow. So it really doesn't matter how you pull off pit road. It's just a matter of when you get back to the start-finish line.
Well, and there's less risk involved here in round two from the standpoint that all these drivers know I'm in the race now, and so the anxiety is gone, and you can play maybe a few more games than you were willing to attempt in round one.
But how big of a game can you play? You can look right up there ahead of you and see how slow they're going. Like, they can't fool you.
Yeah.
But I think it just becomes a matter of who's going to be the most patient, who's going to wait around and try to be the last car in line. This is going to be a throwaway lap as these cars try to position themselves for what will be a flying lap the next time by.
Yeah, you watch the clock here. We're down around a minute probably when they cross the start-finish line, so everybody should have no problems getting back and recording two laps here as we begin round two qualifying. Same rules apply as round one. You get 2.5 minutes, except this time there's only two groups involved. And when we're done, we'll set the field from 13th to 24th, top 12 advancing to run for 2.5 minutes and the pole.
You see Eric Jones has wedged his way into that second group. He's the leader of that second group. He's got three cars behind him. There's a group of five in front of him. If they can gain some ground on that group in front of them, it's going to help their lap times.
Right now, I think I'd still be maybe 3/4 throttle, Phil, not really trying to gain the gap down the back straightaway. Maybe as they roll off four here, if I'm Eric Jones, I have it matted now. We've got that much space to make up in 2.5 miles to have the fastest time of this group. We know that. Let's see if he can time it properly so he can pull that off. I think he's put himself in a perfect spot.
I do too. He obviously knew what he was doing that first round to have the fastest overall speed.
Had a pretty good driver coach over the last couple of years.
Not bad.
With his boss, Kyle Busch.
He does a pretty good job. Four truck wins already and 18 starts now. And he finished second last night, his first time at Daytona.
With a great move coming off turn four to give himself a shot to win that race.
He went to Talladega. He'd never been there, never drafted, was impressive in the truck last fall. Same thing on the road course in Canada. It doesn't seem to matter for Eric Jones. He always is able to adapt.
He's definitely gained ground, so he should have the fastest time, I would think. One of those last three cars are going to have the fastest time in this round.
Time has expired. And at the start-finish line, J.J. Yaley to the top of the board.
He was pushing
Eric Jones.
Eric Jones, and those two cars ran within a couple of hundredths of a second.
And Justin Marks, the other car of that three-car tandem, is third.
Ah, nice. Nice. We'll see how that takes up.
That's a pretty neat picture on the side of that car. That's what you got to do if you're going to be tough here at Daytona. Be
way to go, JJ. Way to go.
Tough like a bull.
Yaley has got a couple of poles here at Daytona in the NASCAR Xfinity Series and has been the quickest in his group now, both in round one and round two, and he's only got to do it one more time.
That's just good planning, Adam.
Nice job by Eric Jones. He led the group off pit road, got out there, backed off, got wedged in behind a group of five cars, sucked he and J.J. Yaley and Justin Marks up to that group, and they're the top three speeds.
That looked pretty simple, didn't it?
Yeah.
How come it hadn't looked that way?
I don't know.
Before.
Dakota Armstrong, who won the pole here in July for the Xfinity Series race. His only career pole was fourth here in the opening group of round two and will be one of those that's, you know, right on the borderline of having an opportunity to advance. Jeff Green and Ross Chastain, the two drivers that did not go out here in group one, round two. So the 10 drivers that recorded speed have now pulled back down to the pit lane and will put 12 more drivers out, and the top 12 overall speeds advance to run for the pole. Then we take another 10-minute break and reset and do it all again to find out who will lead us to the green.
And we already know that Josh Rayom is not going to go out for his round, so we're only going to have 11 cars, which means J.J. Yaley is locked in to the final round if Josh Rayom does not make an attempt.
And those cars that make up Group B here in our second round starting to back out and make their way down to the front end of the pit lane.
Tough like bull.
It's So as we continue the festivities here at Daytona, we remind you, following qualifying for Xfinity cars, we'll send you to Charlotte. A weekend edition of NASCAR Race Hub. It's next on Fox Sports 1. And then they fire it right back here to Daytona. Danielle Trotta, Larry McReynolds, Kenny Wallace get you set up for the opening race of the season for the NASCAR Xfinity Series. That's at 3 o'clock Eastern time, and at 3:30, it's all about getting that checkered flag. So a look back at how things unfolded here for Group 1. Told you J.J. Yaley's at the top. Rayum saying, I'm not going to run. And he's scheduled for Group 2, so as Phil pointed out, with 12 advancing, Yaley knows he's going to have an opportunity to run for the pole, and that's big.
As will Eric Jones. I'm pretty sure those first three will stand up. They put themselves in the perfect situation. They were able to gap the lead pack and close it to nothing, just about nothing at the checker flag. So great job by those three cars.
And the reason those three, we think, are locked into the next round, all 12 cars or all 11 cars can't put themselves in the right spot. Someone's got to lead this pack.
That's right. And it's going to be Regan Smith that leads them off pit road. Who will
possibly
lead them?
Possibly.
I bet you he does. And then the question is, who will lead them back to the start-finish line?
Regan, the really only one of the junior motorsports cars that has had much work out for him so far in qualifying. Chase Elliott, Dale Earnhardt Jr., not able to advance to the top 24. So they'll have to start deeper in the field. And I'm telling you, you look at Group 2 here in our second round, and we got some pretty big names, and wouldn't be surprised at all to see the pole sitter for today's race come from this group that's out on the track right now, or will be soon once NASCAR gives the green light.
All, only 10 cars in line right now, so there may be somebody else that is going to elect not to make an attempt in this round.
Dale Jr., since he didn't move on to round two, he got his phone and went to Twitter, says he's using the championship provisional today. Starting last again, it's been a theme for him. You saw it here on Thursday night in the Budweiser duel. He didn't stay back there long, did he?
Things you say at 40. That's his hashtag. It's good to be the champ, right? And he's proven here in Daytona that he can get it done. The wins he's had so far, defending Daytona 500 champion, he's got a lot going for him. But he had to use a champion's provisional to get in the Xfinity race. How tough is this series?
Hey, you and I are doing the race later today. Tune in, because you get to watch Dale Jr. drive from the back to the front at Daytona. It doesn't get any better than that. Not even 10 seconds into the session, and everybody has rolled off of pit road, and here we go.
Phil, what if you tore off pit road like we saw Regan Smith do and just haul butt all the way around to the start-finish line and then flare up high and let off? Well, they're not all going to do that.
Right.
That gives you the chance to fall to the back and get your run at the next lap.
And the next lap is going to be the one that's going to count anyway.
This isn't going to matter. The group's fault, it's stretched out enough to where...
But his spotters are telling him that right now there's a gap behind this lead group. You see, looks like maybe Brad Keselowski, he's pretty much by himself, then another gap back to the next car.
Maybe that's the plan for this. Front of this group was just to go and get it done and not give someone a chance to suck up. But the there's two cars tied together about a half a straightaway back. Those last
Ryan
two cars.
Ryan Sieg, Brian Scott, I believe.
They don't get too much traffic getting there. This next lap could be special for those two, but it looks like they're going to get blocked off turn two.
So everybody will come around and record a lap here. But it's the next lap that should be the fastest for this group to determine who moves on.
This little four-pack here could do something special. It's going to be tough. That's a pretty big gap. But there's only four cars that are tightly bunched together at the front. And they're not getting any help from the air. The cars that are coming off four now, that's enough of a draft where it should be a bit of an advantage for those four.
Yeah, Brad Keselowski has joined that group now. He's right behind Brian Scott.
And out there with them, three guys that have had some success. You talked about Sieg last year, top 10 both races here. We know Brad and Brian can get it done. How about the rookie, Cale Conley, jumping in, driving that 14 car for TriStar Motorsports this weekend, making his first trip to Daytona.
He just isn't able to keep tucked in tight enough to help those guys, Bill. I don't know if those three cars can make progress, but I do like the fact that they're getting a little bit of drafting help, and there's only four cars grouped together at the front.
Time has expired in round two. This is going to be it to determine who moves on to round three and an opportunity to run for the pole. Regan Smith jumped up to fourth momentarily.
Here comes the cars we're wondering about. Can they get up there?
No, Brad, and they do not.
Brad Keselowski, 14th. Brian Scott, 15th. Ryan Sieg, 16th.
Just wasn't close enough to get that three-car pack to run what the four-car pack ahead of them did.
Ryan Reed, able to advance, jumps up to fifth. Yaley, Eric Jones, Justin Marks, Chris Buescher, Ryan Reed, the top five. Then it's Elliott Sadler, Regan Smith, who won this race a year ago, Dakota Armstrong, who got a pole here last summer, Brendan Gaughan, Eric Almirola, Chad Boat, Austin Dillon, the top 12 that will move on and have a chance to claim the pole here today at Daytona.
As we take a look at J.J. Yaley, who led that second round, how about Chad Boat making the top 12 here? He had to qualify on time, did not have enough points to fall back on, did an outstanding job.
And his dad, Billy, owns a Truck Series team with Mason Mingus. They missed out because of misfortune last night in Truck Series qualifying, did not make the season opener. A lot of anxiety in that 84 camp this morning about qualifying. It's all worked out. He's going to be in the field. In fact, he's in our final round. You see the dozen here that will have a chance to run for the pole at Daytona. So far, J.J. Yaley has been quickest.
Get in the field. You guys don't have the points. How are you feeling about things right now?
I feel pretty good. We got this fresh from Florida Ford Mustang in the race here, and these guys worked awfully hard to bring a really good car down here, and I was just so stressed out that something out of our control, you know, could potentially make us miss the race. So far everything has worked out. I don't know that it's worked out to plan, because we've had plans that have not really gone accordingly the last two sessions, but nonetheless, we can play all the cat and mouse we want to now, because the worst thing will happen is we'll end up 12th. So really proud of all these guys at Biagi Denbesti Racing. They brought me a really nice car, and I'm excited. We're going to have some fun today. We're going to race.
Nice work. He's 10th right now, Vin.
Well, and score one for the little guy. Chad Boat and this Billy Boat Motorsports team is in the final 12, going to the final round. Chad, how do you now play a little risk versus reward in how you approach this final segment?
You know, obviously we're just going to be smart. We're obviously going to have a pretty decent starting spot for the race. So we'll just be smart in this last group. You know, take what it gives us. Really happy for Billy Boat Motorsports and CorvetteParts.net. Cannot say thank you enough to them. They worked really hard this offseason. Built me a great car to come down here with. ECR power isn't hurting. So, you know, I think we'll have a really good day. We just got to keep our nose clean and be there at the end.
Yeah, a really good story with this 84 team. Chad Boat.
Great to see him in the field, Vince. Good start to the year. Plan is to run all of the plate races here, Talladega, back here, Daytona this summer, and do maybe a little bit of a road course stuff. Charlotte is on their plan, so that's good for that 84 team, and probably going to see Chad running some races over in the Camping World Truck Series in 2015.
Yeah, as a teammate to Mason Mingus, you mentioned Mason earlier, unfortunately was a victim of the qualifying format, did not make that race last night.
Billy Boat, a guy that had so much success in the open wheel ranks. Good to see him over on the stock car side, investing in both the NASCAR Xfinity and Camping World Truck Series. Place this weekend here at Daytona International Speedway. Among the items on NASCAR's to-do list, unveiling the trophy for the inaugural season for the NASCAR Xfinity Series. And in November, down at Homestead Miami Speedway, someone will claim that. On hand for the unveiling, the man who won the title last year, Chase Elliott, Elliott Sadler, Bubba Wallace. And here's something interesting. You know, Scott Lagasse missed the show, but Jeff Green, who is the team car at TriStar, made it. So it is going to be Scott Lagasse driving the 10, and they're going to go back. And I would say they'll label up that 10 car because the sponsor for Scott is the title sponsor of today's race.
Yeah, that 10 car will look a lot like that 19 car does by the time we come back to pit road for the race, as will there'll be some backup cars that are rode out as well. So while we're gearing up and very excited about this final round to see who's going to get the pole, there's a lot of people that aren't paying any attention to that. They're just heads down working, preparing, getting ready for this race this afternoon.
You know, that trophy was gorgeous, and then all the trophies for the champions are, but that thing could have an oil can with a stick in it, and it'd mean a lot to somebody that's going to get that thing.
It's all about pride, right?
It's Daytona. You know, this is what NASCAR racers live for, to try to win a race at Daytona. I raced this Xfinity race for many, many years and was never able to get to the checkered flag. I led it on the last lap a couple of times and had a shot, but just couldn't win. And, man, this place is what winning's all about.
You got a couple other victories here, though, that you'd probably not trade for an Xfinity win. Am I right in saying that?
You want to win everything. And win every chance.
Greedy.
You
want to be greedy drivers.
Selfish. This is going to be fun, though. See the strategy that goes into getting the pole. You know, this has been fun. It's an entertaining way to qualify the cars. I enjoy doing TV for these qualifying sessions, and it was almost perfect. If it weren't for just a change of the lane at the wrong time by a cat that was trying to squeeze in a hole that wasn't there, this has been entertaining and fun to watch.
I think Elliott Sadler said it best. He said, we owe it to the fans and our viewers to give them a good show.
Let's listen to Elliott. What's he talking about now?
I know you know, Elliott, but we just need to be smart. The horse will be as well. We just don't need to tear a car up. Yeah, I'm thinking about that, too. Might have to just use a head here.
I'd say that message has probably been delivered for everybody that's going out here in this final round.
Elliott's going to practice what he preached, huh? He was telling us how you need to go about qualifying here, and he's like, yep, I understand that. That's going to be my goal. What is that?
That's a giant brain. What is that, like a bounce house or something? Can you jump around inside that thing?
Well, a bouncy house and a Ferris wheel and a bumper cars, all those things are fun to have in the infield. I think kids enjoy that.
There's a cerebellum in there somewhere, isn't there?
I'm sorry?
What, are you a scientist now? Here's what's interesting. You see that Hellman Chevrolet down there on pit road. Of course, the man behind the wheel of that car is Regan Smith. He won this race last year, the season opener at Daytona. Tremendous guy when it comes to the super speedways for Junior Motorsports. He started 19th last year. We know the worst he's going to start today as he tries to go for two in a row in February at Daytona is 12th, because he's among those that will run for the pole. So it's 2 in the East, and we welcome you live on Fox Sports 1 to Daytona International Speedway. A bit delayed, but we continue with NASCAR Xfinity Series qualifying. The final group is lined up out here for round 3. NASCAR Race Hub will come your way when we finish qualifying. Then it's back here to Daytona in roughly an hour. It's race day Xfinity for the opening race of the year, and at 3:30 Eastern time, we get set to go green in the first race of 2015 for 40 hungry drivers.
Let's go, baby. Let's see who gets this pole.
Well, there's 12 of them that aren't that hungry. They're not going.
they making a liar out of me?
Yeah.
They are hungry.
They're very
I'm
hungry.
Sure of it.
And that's why they're not going.
Fastest car so far in town, the 28 of J.J. Yaley.
J.J.'s fine with just everybody sitting right there.
Then absolutely.
Then they'll revert back to the previous round.
And they are lined up on pit road, fastest to slowest, how they finished round 2.
J.J. has no reason to move.
In fact, he's probably hoping no one else moves.
He will not move until someone moves behind him, I know.
And now I think we've worked into that area where we're only going to get one lap.
Yeah, and if they wait another 40 seconds, they won't get that.
Spotters are up there on the roof saying, okay, guys, we have to go by a minute 10 or whatever, even to get one lap.
Yeah, I think maybe
a minute or so.
I don't know, minute. They're a bit past the start-finish line. I think a minute 10, Phil, is about as late as you can wait.
Seconds. We got a minute 20 left, 20 seconds.
Now somebody's saying a minute. They said we have 20 seconds left,
so
obviously they feel like that they can do it in a minute's time.
That's Brett Griffin. He's Elliott Sadler's spotter.
And Elliott's starting to roll now, and as the clock is going to hit about 1 minute as they go to pit exit. It's going to be close.
Grab gears, man. Grab gears. You're the 7.
I would guess some of these cars may not make it back around.
No, I don't think the back guys will make it. And it'll be interesting to see if Yaley even makes it back. And I don't think he really 100%. I mean, he'd love to make it back, but he's going to start the top 6 or 7 if he doesn't make it back, because there's that many cars behind him.
He would have taken that going into the day, I'm sure. And you just have to start your lap before time expires. Obviously, you don't have to complete it, because if that's the case, there'd be no chance anybody was going to get it done.
That's great strategy by J.J. Yaley. Put the ball in someone else's court. The pole was his. Somebody better take it away from me. If I sit here, it's mine.
15 seconds left as they come off of turn 4. And there is no doubt, and we watched the flagman, but there is no doubt some of these guys probably are going to have a hard time getting here.
Oh, it's close. They're going to all make it. They're all going to make it.
And they all did make it because the red and black flags are just now coming out. How about
three.
That?
All cars can complete this lap. All cars.
By 1 second.
Wow. They played it just right, didn't they?
Somebody's got a good calculator. Got to give a lot of credit to Brett Griffin there saying, we got to go, we got to grab some gears. And not only did Elliott go and grab those gears, he brought the whole field with him. But now I think that second pack is where your pole is going to come from. It's just who can close up the most in that group.
How about that third group of two cars? Not enough cars back there, you think? Chris Buescher leading that group of two?
I don't think they can get there, but shoot.
Tell you, a guy to keep an eye on, he's been fast. Right in the middle of that second group is Eric Jones.
Uh-oh.
He
got a bit of a block.
Line. Dakota Armstrong, outside lane, won the pole here last July. At the start-finish line, pole goes to Austin Dillon, the man that won the championship a couple of years ago.
Right there. Pole position.
How about that?
Hey, baby. Good job, boys. Good seat in the back.
How about Justin Marks? Going to start from the outside of the front row.
What would you have given me if I said your front row for today is going to be Austin Dillon, Justin Marks?
I would have given you Austin as a pretty good bet. But Justin, he didn't make the cup race the other night when he attempted. And Billy Boat, look at the Billy Boat up in the
Chad Boat.
Excuse me, Chad Boat up in the third spot. Billy Boat's team really doing a nice job down here in Daytona. This is fun. There's our second place qualifier, Justin Marks.
Great job by Justin, that RAB team.
Elliott Sadler ends up 11th, and he was leading the group as he came off of turn four and then tried to throw the block up high.
Whew. Yeah, fortunately, though, he knew that they had such a head of steam, and he went ahead and got out of the way, knew that it wasn't going to work. There was too much of a disparity in speed.
Regan Smith, the winner here one season ago, second in July, second in the championship in 2014, going to start 12th.
And Elliott Sadler, the guy who started all that, qualifies next to last in 11th in this group.
And just in front of him, Chris Buescher, who one season ago, a victim of Mother Nature, unable to qualify because he had no points, and because of a transfer of points to the Roush Fenway organization, had no points for today. I'm sure anxiety was high for him when the rain hit earlier, but it all works out, and not only did he make the race, he's going to start inside the top 10.
With the exception of a crash in the tri-oval that was very unfortunate, that was an entertaining qualifying match.
So look at our front row for this, the opening race in the NASCAR Xfinity Series in 2015. Austin Dillon leading him to the green for the 11th time in his career. He won the championship in this series 2 years ago. And Justin Marks, who today starting on the front row, is doing so for the first time in his career. You know, Austin's going to run 20 races this year. Paul Menard's going to run, I think, 8, something like that, in the 33. And then you add in Brandon Jones, a young development driver for Richard Childress Racing. Having a fourth car will be big for them, and having Austin behind the wheel going to help today. Let's hear from Jamie Little.
Austin Dillon getting that helmet off. We heard from all these drivers. They were stressed. They were worried. You were one of them walking up and down making plans. What is your thought about all this now that you got the pole?
I don't know, I was doing a lot of lobbying. Felt like a politician out here earlier trying to make things work. But, man, that was fun. I'm glad the Ream Chevrolet's on the pole. Luckily, I was 12th in that last group and kind of could stay back and watch how things played out. I didn't want to be the last car because I knew that if we gapped too much, we wouldn't make it around. But it worked out, and I'm going to take a nice cold swig of this Coca-Cola and go and hopefully have some fun in this Xfinity race.
A little planning, a little luck. Austin Dillon is your pole sitter.
Thank you, Jamie. We are set for the season opener in the NASCAR Xfinity Series. Race day comes your way in about 53 minutes. We're live at 3 p.m. Eastern time back here in Daytona. NASCAR Race Hub is on the way from our Charlotte studios, but right now we're going to Los Angeles. You know them, you love them. Here's Jay and Dan.